It is my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. Sarah Weddington. Dr. Weddington is a nationally known attorney and spokesperson on leadership and public issues. In 1973, she became the first woman from Austin, Travis County to serve in the 150-member Texas House of Representatives, where she served three terms. In 1977, she was the first woman to serve as general counsel of the United States Department of Agriculture, where she supervised more than 200 lawyers. From 1978 to 1981, Dr. Weddington served as assistant to President Jimmy Carter, directing the administration's work on women's issues and leadership outreach. From 1983 to 1985, she was the first female director of the Texas Office of State-Federal Relations. Dr. Weddington was a professor for 28 years at the University of Texas, Austin, where she shaped a new generation of leaders through her classes, Gender-Based Discrimination and Leadership in America. In her first book, A Question of Choice, Dr. Weddington details the landmark case, Roe v. Wade, which she successfully argued as a young attorney before the Supreme Court of the United States in 1971 and 1972. In addition to all of her professional accolades, we are especially proud that Dr. Weddington is a member of Sigma Kappa. She was an honor initiate at our 1994 convention in Dallas, and we are so pleased that she could be with us today. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Sarah Weddington.
To figure out the words to the song. One little piece of advice for all of you who had your pictures taken, get a copy and keep it. Because when I started trying to put these slides together that I'm going to use as a backup for my speech, it took them forever at National Office to find a copy of it. And it's not the best one. So keep one yourselves, because National may need to ask you for that. The other thing I wanted to tell you is both Kelly and Jane will be right outside the ballroom, as I will be, when this is over. So for those of you who want to talk to them, Kelly's got on her special agent for Homeland Security, and so you can get a closer look at that. And I'll be out there as well. So come visit with us, take pictures as you like. I want to thank all of you, both for inviting me to be part of Sigma Kappa, and then also for your kindness in inviting me today. I thought about the theme of the luncheon, a lifetime. And I got to trying to put together in my mind what happened that made it possible for me to do all the things I have. And I have had such a good time and been able to make some real difference in various ways. And so I'm really honored to be here. I wanted to thank especially Jordan Bentledge. Jordan, where are you? I haven't seen you. Oh, stand up. Who you know is executive director and does a great job, runs a great staff, and we're lucky to have her. And then Gina Farrar, where are you, Gina? She's probably in the ladies' room. You know they've taken several men's room and turned them into women's room. I think that was a great idea. And then Mary Phillips Carlson. I think a lot of you would know her. She is not here for lunch because her grandfather is now in hospice, and she has gone home to Pennsylvania to be with him and her grandmother tomorrow, and the other members of the family tomorrow. So, as you would guess, she hated not to be here, but she also just could not be with her grandfather and grandmother at this very critical time. And the Marriott's been good. I love that waterfall. I wish they would pipe in sound to all the rooms. It's really been a delight. And thanks to Anne for being with me years ago. That's almost 20 years ago. And also today. You know, there's an old saying, let's see, and I'm looking for my timer. There you are. Okay, good. You told me you were going to be in my seat. I just hadn't focused on it. Okay. I've often heard it said that we tend in our early years to begin traits and interests that will continue with us throughout life. I laughed when I found this photo because, as you can see, I'm bringing in the newspaper. None of you bring in a newspaper anymore. You just go to your phone and do the whole thing, but I still want the newspaper. And so I was living in a place called Vet Village because my father was in the Navy. He was the chaplain for a troop transport carrier taking Navy personnel to, and Army personnel as well, to the Japan area in regard to World War II. And so when he came back, we lived in a village that the college, McMurray University, it was a college then, had set aside for the members of the services. And so it was a great place to live. Click. That means next slide. I've always enjoyed the out of doors. Now, I can't tell you I caught that fish, but I wouldn't let it go. My cousin caught it. And then I was looking the other day in the triangle for the spring of 2018, and I saw an article on Emma Sepke, Alpha Epsilon Iowa State University, and she's not here, but I bet some are. A little louder, please. Okay. And she had won an ice fishing contest, and her fish is bigger than mine. But it was an interesting article, and she did a great job. Click. Now, in thinking about how did I develop as a leader, because I would hope that each of you would look for ways to develop as a leader, I thought, you know, really, it started young. My father was a minister, and so I was the president of the Methodist Youth Fellowship very early, and then I was the drum major for the Canyon Junior High Band. And what I learned was I was a person who, if something happened and I thought it was wrong, I would try to change it. For example, I played basketball in high school at a time only a few of you would remember, when women were only allowed to run half court. And after that, you had to throw the ball, after two dribbles, you had to throw the ball to somebody else on your team, and they could take two dribbles, and they had to throw it to somebody. And I was one of those people saying, "This is, I can run full court," and I could then. Why can't we just keep running? And my coach would say, "Oh no, all that jiggling and rebounding. Why, you might hurt your innards, and that is your meal ticket." And I felt sure I could find another meal ticket. And so one of the things I was able to accomplish in the legislature was helping the movement, which was opening up basketball to run full court. So not long ago, I was invited to be the guest coach for the University of Texas women's basketball team. And they're really good. So I went in, I didn't know I was being taped. And so I gave them my speech and all, and they won the game. It broke their losing streak. And one of my friends wrote me and she said, "Do you think the men's football team would let you visit them?" Well, I haven't gotten an invitation yet. But it was great to just watch them run up and down the court, because it was something they said women couldn't do, and we can. Or I look back at college, and I went to the Dean of Students at McMurray College then. I'm going to quit saying college then, just McMurray. And I said to the dean, "I want to run for either president or vice president of the student body." And he said, "Well, you can't do that." And I said, "Why not? I have very good grades. I helped to start a local sorority called Theta Chi. It's won a lot of things on the campus. I've done a lot of things for the university." And he said, "Yes, but only men are the president or the vice president." That made me so mad. I went back to the dorm, and my roommate was named Susie Benham. And so I'm taking it out on her in a way about, "I can't believe the dean said this, and it's so terrible, and we've got to change this." And Susie said, "Sarah, there's always a way around obstacles." She said, "We could nominate my boyfriend for president. We could nominate your boyfriend for vice president. We could nominate you for secretary. And they don't care as much as we do, so we'll run the school." So Susie and I, S&S, ran the university, but she was very helpful to me in sort of out-of-the-box thinking. I didn't have to have my name on the president's line. I just had to have the relationship with the vice president, who would do whatever I suggested would. So it was really at McMurray that I had a woman who helped me. She was my speech teacher, Carolyn Couch Blair. And with her, I did the debate, I did extemporaneous speaking, I did poetry interp, I did all kinds of speech contests, really. And she was great, and she taught me so much. And after I won Roe versus Wade, Carolyn Couch Blair called me and she said, "Oh, congratulations, Sarah, we've won again." And she does get part of the credit. And then my English teacher was a woman named Dr. Selma Bishop. And she was one of those women who always had a stack of books in her arm, and you were just hoping she wasn't going to drop a bunch of them as she went down the aisle. And I think she had a special red pen that she reserved only for my papers, because she was very generous in her suggestions. But I'm also grateful that she was, because then when I was writing a variety of things in my lifetime in leadership, I really could write much better than a lot of other, and it was very helpful to me. Click. When I got to Austin, I was in law school. I was the secretary for the law class. But after I finished law, well, I should go back just real quickly. Before I went to law school, I came from McMurray, went to Austin, and I was a clerk typist for the Texas legislature. So you type all that. Now, of course, I was on a typewriter. Those are considered antiques today. But I would, type out whatever bills the legislature had passed, and then I would help to proof it And I was really good at proofing and typing, by the way. Typing got me a lot of jobs. Now I wouldn't. Y'all are better because you know computers in a way I don't. But I decided after I finished that and finished law school that I would run for the Texas legislature. Because when I had finished, you know, when I had breaks or lunch hours, I would go out and sit in the gallery of the legislature and watch them. And I thought, I could do that and hopefully better. And so it was one of those points we were starting to say we need more women in the legislature. And so I thought, well, you know, I'm a lawyer. I've worked for the legislature. I have lots of credentials. I'll run. Now, the one thing I didn't have was money. But at that point in Austin, you didn't have to have the kinds of money that you do now. And so I served in the legislature. Kay Bailey Hutchison, a Republican friend, and I passed the bills that allowed women to have credit without their husband or their father's permission. Texas A&M was a great school, but women weren't allowed to go. So Kay and I and a few others, there weren't many of us in the legislature, but we convinced the powers that be that women ought to be admitted. And today they're about half of the Texas A&M student body. And also there were only men in the Corps of Cadets. And I couldn't figure out anything the Corps of Cadets was doing that women couldn't do. So we also asked them to open that up to women. And now I think for the first year there's a woman who's head of the Corps of Cadets. And there's a lot of advances. Click. Now, I haven't seen a time. Okay. So when I ran for the legislature, my entire staff was women, because they didn't mind taking orders or suggestions from me. And this is Ann Richards on the far left. She was a manager in my office. Now, there's so many stories about when she ran for governor, and as you know, was elected. And I always think when you're elected to something like that, it's partly the candidate's good graces, good experience, and it's partly that the candidate on the other side is horrible. And in this case, Ann was very lucky. She had an opponent named Clady Williams, who I'm sure is a very pleasant person. I didn't look at him that way at the time. But, for example, he had taken a group of people who were writers, reporters, out to his ranch. And it started kind of sprinkling. And he said to the assembled group, "Oh, rain is just like rape. If you can't do anything about it, then just lean back and enjoy it." That did not go well in Texas. Or, for example, at one point a reporter asked him if he had ever been to Mexico. And he said, "Well, of course. My friends and I at Texas A&M used to go to Mexico to be serviced." That did not go over well. He did a number of things, I won't go into all of them, that really helped Ann. I don't think he meant to, but that's the way it was. Click. When I became general counsel of agriculture, let's see, one, two, three of those gentlemen are forest rangers. And this is a picture taken when we did a 10-day horseback trip into the wilderness of Montana. It's the Big Bear Wilderness area. And now I have helped to start a foundation that raises money for the work of the foundation. They have programs in the summer. They have programs for younger women. They have programs for people who want to help clear the trails who want to use a, what do they call it? Not a chainsaw, but a half. Tell me again. A Pulaski. They have training for women to use Pulaskis and all kinds of things. It's really a wonderful experience. And part of the reason I loved it was at night we camped out, and the forest rangers always told stories about the bear that broke into the cabin, the bear that got away, the bear. They were such interesting stories. And I had a great time, and I knew I really loved it when the last day it was raining, it was cold, my boots were filling up with rain, water, and if I put my foot down in the stirrup, all the water ran to the toe, and then I would put my boot back and all the water would run to the heel, and I was just happy as I could be. And the forest rangers knew I was going to be complaining, but I didn't. It was great to be there. And we had a mule train that carried the food for the horses, and sometimes for us as well. And I will never forget. Of course, I wanted to do anything the men were doing. So on one occasion, the men typically, one of them would have the rope from the mule train to their horse. And so came the day, I thought I would be the one to have the rope from the mule train to my horse. And they were sort of saying, oh, you don't need to do that. And I said, no, I want to do everything y'all do. And so they said, okay, here's the rope. And I got on the horse, my horse, and the lead mule started wrapping him or herself. All mules are men, aren't they? Let's see. The lead mule was basically wrapping himself around a tree. And I was so embarrassed. And so I got off of my horse. I ran back there. I looked that mule straight in the face and said, I'm so sorry. And then all the forest rangers started laughing. It was the best part of the day. It's really a great click. Click, click. Okay. Oh, go back to that other one. And then one day at agriculture, I got a call from President Carter saying, I need an assistant. Would you be willing to leave agriculture and come over to my White House? And at first I said, oh no, I can't do that. I've got this list of things I have yet to accomplish. I couldn't do that at all. And then the next day, Rosalynn Carter called me and she said, well, you could at least come have lunch with the president and with me. And if you look at the Oval Office in the back, that is the Oval Office. So once I went to lunch and he said, let me show you around and talk to you about what I hope you'll do, I couldn't say no. And so the only thing I took with me from agriculture is a sign that was on my parking place. On the apron of the agriculture department, and it says, no parking, reserved for General Counsel Sarah Weddington. And it's over the toilet in my office. But there were so many parts of being there that were really interesting and exciting. For example, as you know, Carter really created the Camp David Accords. President Sadat of Egypt, the president of Israel. Then he had to sell it. And so he put me in charge of having a series of briefing sessions for various people about what it was, what it's meant to do, why it should be passed. And I really enjoyed that. Now, when he first asked me to do this, he said, now I want to tell you in advance that your partner, essentially, in doing this will be Hosni Mubarak, who was the vice president of Egypt. Hosni Mubarak was an Egyptian who had been a general in the Egyptian Air Force, who had been educated to some extent in the U.S., spoke excellent English. But I thought, oh, he's not used to having a woman as an equal, and actually I'll be the one in charge. And I thought, well, he'll just have to get used to it. So it turned out he was wonderful to work with. He basically was very good to work with, took questions from people, never took offense. There were just a lot of good things about it. And as you know, the Camp David Accords did succeed. And then one day the president called me and he said, Sarah, what are you doing for the holidays? And I said, well, I don't have any special plans right now. And he said, well, I need you to go to Oman. And he said, if you don't mind, we'll do a commercial flight for you to New York, no, to London, and the Omani plane will pick you up there. It'll be a plane for two people. You'll be one of them. It'll have a flight attendant or more than one for each person. And I think you'll find it a really pleasant flight. So I agreed to go. And yesterday when I was getting on Delta, I couldn't help but think, oh, for the Omani plane. But Delta has now changed their uniforms and they're purple. So that was fun to notice. If you're on Delta on this trip, notice the color of the, particularly the attendant uniforms. Let's see. Well, there's so many stories, but I've got to move along so we can take questions. This is the Oval Office, as you can tell. And Marty Ginsburg may have helped his wife get the Supreme Court appointment. But I was the one who got her the D.C. Circuit federal appointment. So Carter had said to me, there are so few women in the federal judges' positions. I want you to take special effort to get women put in federal judgeships. And I said, okay. And he said, of course, you give me the nominations and I'll make the final decision, but I will put a lot of weight in your recommendations. So there were three of us on a committee that Carter appointed. It was me, Frank Moore, congressional liaison, thank you, and Ben Civiletti, who was then the head of the Justice Department. So we had this meeting about the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, and I wanted Ruth Bader Ginsburg. I had known her as a lawyer, and I said to some of the women at my table who are lawyers, you know, I have a copy of the Roe versus Wade decision that all the justices have signed. I think it's probably the only one. No one else can tell me about a decision with all the judges having signed it. Year two, as long as you'll vote for Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And he said, well, okay. But you could tell the way he said it, that if there was any way he could keep it from happening, he would. And so I started waiting for the announcement, and it wasn't happening. And I went down to the president. My office was just above his, and there was a staircase. So I just went down to the president's office, and I said, Mr. President, I want to tell you what's happening. And I described to him the meeting we'd had, what we were recommending, at least I was, and said to him, you know, I've never leaked before in the entire time I've been here in the White House, but unless you tell me not to, I'm going to leak that Ruth Bader Ginsburg will get the D.C. Circuit appointment. He said, that's fair. So I leaked it. She got it. I don't know what Ben Civiletti thought about it. I never spoke to him again. And there were lots of other things. So another one, I went to a funeral of a Moroccan king, because obviously his wife was female and they wanted someone in the delegation to go to Well, that bring her greetings from the president. And Muhammad Ali was on that plane. So I was in charge of Muhammad Ali. Nobody is in charge of Muhammad Ali. And he kept saying, oh, Sarah, there are going to be so many people that are going to be mobbing me. Do you have enough security for this? And I said, I think so. And so we did have enough security. But he was very concerned about it. Click. This, as you can see, is Mrs. Lady Bird Johnson, her daughter, Lucy, President Carter, and me. And we had just been, Lady Bird started a garden center, wildlife center, and so we had just been to a fundraiser for her effort, and then all of us got together for a cocktail afterwards. Click. This is the only picture I have with Queen Elizabeth. Now, I look back, and I think about all kinds of weird things. For example, I got really concerned about what was in her purse. So I asked one of her security guys, what's in her purse? And he said, well, she doesn't really need anything. You know, she doesn't have to show her passport to leave the country or get into the country. She doesn't need money. We do all that. And so it turned out she uses her purse to signal her staff. So if the purse is where it is in that, can you all can see over here, can't you? Then it says, I'm fine, you don't need to do anything. If she moves it up to her elbow, that means, come here. But she said, a queen can't go like that. And so they have a signal worked out. She was really delightful. Her jewels were spectacular. And I don't know what Anne is thinking at that moment. And of course, I didn't think to curtsy. We don't curtsy, or I don't. But it was a wonderful event, and I was pleased to be part of it. Click. And this is the only picture, well, they found two pictures, but this is the best of the two. And they didn't even find one of Anne and I together. That's why I'm saying, y'all be sure and keep a copy of your picture. Okay, click. Molly Ivins is a writer. Some of you may have read some of her stuff. She was a funny writer. And then Liz Carpenter, who had worked in government a long time. Liz was a most delightful friend. For example, she gave me a number of little things when she was getting ready to clean out her house. And one of them I have by my bed, and it says, the best antiques are old friends. And I really believe that. And so as I was reading The Triangle, I came across the article from the spring 2018, written, nope, that's not the one I want, just a minute, sorry. It was from the winter 2018 by Ashley Yalali, and I know she's not here, but she's from Theta Omicron, and I know some of her sisters are here. Well, tell her I enjoyed her article. And it's called Kappa Sigma, Sigma Kappa Saved My Life. And it goes on and talks about a hard time in her life and how much her sisters meant. Or I was reading an article just recently on as you age, what keeps your life worth living? And it said you need good friends. That is the key to aging well. And so I do think what was said earlier by other speakers about Sigma Kappa being a major part of what would make a life wonderful. Okay, click. Okay, read fast. Click. Click. Now, We have a state cemetery in Austin. In 1973, as a new legislator, I went and picked out the place where I wanted to be buried. It was right by Bigfoot Wallace, who was a Texas Ranger, a raconteur, single. And I thought, well, you know, that'd be interesting for conversation. And so I had my place. Well, then I went to Paris one day, and I went, you know, there's a Sunday morning tour that's not real expensive, but the guide tells you the places various people are buried, and then someone comes out from behind their tombstone. For example, one of the things the guide said, and this is the place where Simone de Beauvoir is buried. And then from behind the gravestone, a person comes out in full period costume and says, I am Simone de Beauvoir, and then tells you about her life. And I thought, well, that would be neat for Texas women to do. Only there are not very many of us in the cemetery. And I was talking to one of the state legislators recently, and I said, you know, I need more women to apply for the state cemetery. And if you're a legislator, if you're a district judge, various things, you are entitled to, well, it used to be two spaces, now it's just one. So the only question is, who's going to be on top? So I went out there to look at my space. There was someone in it. I was furious. It was the lieutenant governor who had put one of his good friends in my place. But I didn't want to dig him up. So eventually I agreed to accept a different space. And this is that different space. But I didn't want anybody being able to take my place this time. So that's about 14,000 tons of, it's not quite that much, but I think it is, of marble, because I don't think anybody can take that and get it out of the cemetery. So it's going to be there when I'm ready for it. And we now call it pre-need. And a number of other legislators and state elected officials are there. Quick story, Ann Richards, when she was very sick and it looked like would not last for a very long time, wanted to have her boyfriend buried next to her because her husband and she had been divorced and he was marrying someone else soon. And she was really mad about it. And so she said, well, I want Bud Schrake, my boyfriend, buried by me. But that didn't fit the rules. So Ann said, I'm so upset about this. And I said, Ann, you are the governor. And she said, oh, yes. So she changed the rules. So if you're the governor and you sign a proclamation, you can put whoever you want to next to you. And Bud Schrake is right there. And then next to him is the guy who wrote Best Little Whorehouse in Texas. But there's so many other people there, and one of these days when you're in Austin, go see the cemetery. Remember the movie American Sniper? Chris? Kyle. He's buried there. The two police officers who went up the tower at the University of Texas when there was a guy up on the top ledge was shooting down below on students and faculty and visitors, and the two police officers are now there. At one point, well, of course, the coach for the Texas football team is buried there. And if you're on the Texas football team, there's a big Texas ring. And so his ring is on his gravestone. And then he got the university to set aside a place for the coach of the Dallas Cowboys, who was a real favorite in Texas, but he was from Dallas. So when he died, his wife said, I'm not gonna let him be buried in the state cemetery. He is from Dallas. And so that's where he's buried. But there is a cintigraph you know, the medal with writing on it about him and his accomplishments and all that. And the people at the State Cemetery told me that it is the most visited place in the State Cemetery, Daryl Royal. And then the first woman governor of Texas is buried there. Barbara Jordan is buried there. And I learned a lot watching, because I always learn to watch and learn from Barbara Jordan. I'll never forget, a few of you would remember this as well, when she was doing a speech in Congress and she said, "The Constitution. The Constitution is a document that guarantees equality." Equality. Equality. And so as I near the very end of my speech, I want to say to you, I am so grateful for letting me participate, for learning from you as well as trying to teach you some of the things I've learned. And I hope that someday we can accomplish what Barbara Jordan said, and that is equality, equality, equality. Thank you. Thank you very much. Got it.